Tim Cook's success story. Most people knew the late Steve Jobs as the face of Apple, but there was another man who stood back to back with him. Them against the world when Apple was nothing more than a ghost in the tech industry. That man's name is Timothy Donald Cook. And it is no bold claim to state that without him, neither Apple nor the genius of the great Steve Jobs would have shone through. In today's video, we will look at the man who worked alongside Jobs to build the Apple everyone knows today, to use his life story to inspire young people who may be discouraged about life. We hope that this video gives you the courage you need to believe in yourself and pursue your biggest dreams. If you're new here, consider subscribing so that you won't miss other interesting videos like this. Tim Cook was born on November 1, 1960 in Mobile, Alabama, USA. He is the son of Donald and Geraldine Cook and the middle child of three boys. Between raising children and working long hours in their respective jobs, both parents had it rough. Even though Geraldine was a homemaker, she worked her spare hours at a local pharmacy. As for Donald, he worked as a shipyard worker. In those days, Cook learned that the job was both hazardous and time-consuming. Thankfully, no ill event ever befell his father Cook. Cook will eventually lose count of how many times his old man came home bone-tired. Such a sight must have left a strong impression upon young Cook. He had probably wondered, surely isn't there some process to make things run with ease for people like him or others? So the little boy began his journey on that quest. After finishing his high school education at Robertsdale High School, Cook proceeded to the next milestone on his quest, Urban University, Alabama. In 1982, he acquired his bachelor's degree in industrial engineering, a certification that would serve him well in later years. Fresh from Auburn University, Cook eventually got himself a job at IBM within the same year, everyone's favorite American company of the 80s. All reliable, Big Blue. Not only was the corporation number one in supplying computer systems at the time, but they also had a reputation for treating their employees as their greatest assets, thereby securing their fierce loyalty in return. Furthermore, IBM's motto of think encouraged Cook, no doubt challenging him to think of what he could do differently. And he went above and beyond in that aspect. Throughout the years, Cook's excellent and consistent performances fostered his rise up the corporate ladder. He earned respect from his peers who welcomed his hard work ethics and competencies. Even one of his bosses, Richard Doherty, remarked and said, Cook was one of those people who nobody could ever hate, and they would instead tell you how much they loved working with the man. Before long, Cook found himself appointed as IBM's Director of North American Fulfillment. He would thank his stars for studying industrial engineering. His new job position demanded a laser-focused oversight over IBM's distribution and manufacturing process. He ensured things ran as smoothly and efficiently as possible. Cook dedicated himself to fulfilling IBM's orders, so much so he worked through Christmas and New Year holidays. He would probably realize he needed to focus on the human side of the business. Not that optimizing system processes and machines wasn't already a challenge enough. However, it wouldn't do him any favors to be ill-equipped in the business world. During this period, Cook gained another certification to his name, an MBA degree from Duke University, Fuqua School of Business. He graduated among the top 10% of the class, receiving the award of Fuqua Scholar. Hardly anyone would dare look at Cook's resume twice before hiring him. In 1994, Cook joined Intelligent Electronics as Chief Operating Officer, COO, of the reseller division. He was in charge of both the administrative and operational units of a division that purchased IT products and services to market them directly to customers. Cook spent the next 3 years at Intelligent Electronics. He left for Compaq after Intelligent Electronics sold its reseller division to Ingram Micro in 1997. Hardly had 6 months passed for Cook when he met Steve Jobs of Apple Incorporated. For months, the man continued approaching him with his job offer. Jobs had heard what Cook had done for IBM, Intelligent Electronics, and now Compaq, and wanted someone like him on his side at Apple. At the time, Apple was going through some tough times in a fiercely competitive tech market, and that was putting the company's billion-dollar losses mildly, if that was at all possible. Those who knew Cook at Compaq did their best to discourage him from taking Jobs' offer. "You'll be rowing right up a sinking ship," they said. The media wouldn't shut up about it in the news. Hell, even the great Michael Dell of Dell Corporation offered his 2 cents about Apple, and he'd rather put the company out of its misery. Surely, the business-like logical part of Cook's brain must have analyzed the cost and benefits of the job offer. He must have known the cost outweighed the benefits so much that it wasn't funny to even wonder why Jobs would approach anyone in the first place. Yet, for some weird, indescribable reason, Cook threw caution to the wind and jumped ship. Whether this would be a good choice remains a matter of hindsight. If Cook had the slightest inkling of the decline Compaq would suffer by the start of the 2000s, he would rate his vision 20/20. For now, the year was 1998, and Jobs appointed Cook to assume the office of Apple's Senior Vice President of Worldwide Operations, a fitting choice. Of course, now that Cook was within the belly of the sick beast, Cook quickly diagnosed what ailed Apple. He probably must have thought at this point, what the hell was it thinking when he accepted this? Regardless, a job was a job, and it was his job to remove redundancies and let Apple gain a foothold. He quickly narrowed it down to Apple's operations, where he discovered it was being burdened by the carrying cost of the stockpiled inventory the corporation left in its factories and warehouses for such a long time. Ever the man for efficiency and few direct words, Cook realized a plan of action. He shut down these storage locations, thus lowering Apple's inventory, which slashed their costs significantly. If Apple was going to manufacture certain components, then it was best to leave it to the external manufacturers. And this will become Apple's modus operandi until today. This act of his, as well as his continued supervision of Apple's operation, turned the corporation's fortunes around. Many now looked to Cook, who seemed to have the touch of Midas. By 2005, if not for Cook's foresight in investing in flash memory and predicting his technology would become the mainstream for the next decade, Apple would have faced an uphill struggle in creating their iPods, iPhones, and iPads in subsequent years. In 2007, Cook was promoted to Apple's Chief Operating Officer, COO, and briefly served as interim CEO in 2009 while Jobs was away struggling with pancreatic cancer. After Jobs resigned as CEO, Cook was named the new Chief Executive Officer of Apple Incorporated on August 24, 2011. Thank you very much for watching our videos. We'd like to give you another interesting video for you to enjoy next. Well, before then, our team will be very happy if you can like this video and share it with your friends on social media. If you're new here, don't forget to subscribe so you won't miss other interesting videos like this. Look at your screen now to see two other interesting videos we handpicked for you to enjoy next. We love you.